Hello, everybody. We'll get going. There may be a few more people who are coming in, but welcome to the Institute for Government. One of our big themes at the Institute for Government is the way in which academia can help policymakers, and in particular, how academic research can help inform better policymaking. So I'm really delighted this evening to be able to welcome Professor Alexander Betts, who is the director of the, I must read this out, of the Refugee Studies Centre at the University of Oxford, and is Professor of Forced Migration and International Affairs there, and Professor Paul Collier, who is Professor of Economics and Public Policy at the Bravatnik School of Government at Oxford, are both well known for numbers of publications, and both on Foreign Policy's list of leading global thinkers in 2016. Both have come together to produce this book, Refuge, which is a very interesting discussion of the failure of the world system to cope adequately with the refugee crisis, and particularly relevantly given the Institute for Government's current focus on Brexit, mine's concentrated in particular by the triggering of Article 50 tomorrow. Very interesting discussion of policy failure within the EU, the interaction of Schengen and the Dublin regulation, when the EU was forced to take a bit of responsibility for refugees in 2015. Alice and Paul's book, it's a really interesting diagnosis of what they think has gone wrong, and then more constructively, as well as setting out what's gone wrong, produces some ideas for what might be done to improve things. So what we're going to do is, Alex first is going to set out the diagnosis of the problem. Paul is then going to set out the pillars of their proposed solution. And then what I'm very keen to do is to have a real sort of debate with them. And that really means drawing on your expertise. I know we've got a number of experts, advocates in the audience. And I already know from tweeting this event out that there are a number of people there who don't necessarily share the analysis in this book. So I hope we get a really good policy-focused debate going. We'll run that till about 6:45. Then we'll go outside. There will be opportunities for those of you who have not already bought the books to buy the books, opportunities for those of you who have to get your books signed, and then we'll have the usual networking, drinks and canapes. So to pitch in, without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Alexander Betts.
Thank you, Jill, and thank you to all of you for coming. I know sort of 5:30 at the end of a work day around Westminster and Whitehall is not the most attractive time, so we're grateful to have you here. This is a book that we've written not as an academic aside, but as something for the general public and policymakers. It's our attempt to say that the so-called refugee crisis has solutions, that following a few simple steps, it needn't be an intractable global challenge, that we need to get it in perspective, and there are ways to come up with meaningful responses. So how is it that we came to work on this? How is it that someone like me, who directs a research centre focused on refugees, and someone like Paul, an eminent development economist, came to work together? Well, rewind 2 years ago, and Paul got an invitation from a Jordanian think tank, struggling with the challenge of working in a country with officially 600,000 refugees, but if you ask the government, over 1 million Syrian refugees, and they wanted to draw on the expertise of a development economist. And Paul and I brainstormed some ideas, and then we traveled together to Jordan. And we did the kind of usual visit that a lot of outsiders do to Amman and Zaatari. And we were shocked by the conditions of 83,000 Syrians in the Zaatari refugee camp. But just as an aside, our guide, a little bit bored of showing us refugee-related issues, happened to take us to something he was very proud of his government's involvement in, which was an economic zone, a special economic zone just 15 minutes away. And he showed us this, but it seemed regrettable that having invested around £100 million in connecting it to the electricity grid and the road network, it lacked two things. It lacked access to workers and foreign direct investment. And yet just 15 minutes away were 83,000 Syrian refugees languishing, idle, without work, many of whom had just told us that the thing they wanted most was the ability to work. We heard stories of people who had young children who had chosen to go back to Syria, chosen to take boats to Europe for lack of opportunity. And so we put two and two together and possibly came up with five, but that became the basis of the brainstorming that became the Jordan compact. And Paul will say more about this. But obviously, that trip was in April 2015. And something else happened in April 2015. The start of the so-called European refugee crisis. 700 people drowned crossing from Libya and attempting to get to Lampedusa. And at that point, there was intense political and media interest in refugees coming to Europe. And we watched and observed and continued to engage in the debate around this Jordan model. But as we watched the lack of solutions, the lack of policy ideas, the lack of political leadership, we decided that we would continue our collaboration and try to work on this book. It's not the final word. It's an attempt to stimulate an approach based on the idea that we can find workable solutions rooted in a development-based approach. I think it's worth bearing in mind what that refugee crisis really is and was. We need a degree of perspective. The level of migration in the world relative to the global population is relatively constant since the 1970s. We had around 70 million migrants in 1970. We've got around 230 million today. But as a proportion of the world's population, it's relatively constant. Equally, the number of refugees in the world is a relatively small and relatively constant proportion of the overall number of migrants. Yes, we have 20 million refugees today. Yes, we have more people displaced than at any time since the Second World War. But it should be manageable. 20 million people against the backdrop of a global population of 7 billion is relatively small. So why the crisis? Well, I think there were three things that were relatively new and challenging, particularly for European governments. Firstly, fragility was driving these movements. Not persecution as we'd seen in the past, but fragile states. 50% of the world's refugees were from Syria, Somalia, and Afghanistan, just three countries. Secondly, mobility was new. Technology and smuggling networks were for the first time allowing large-scale transcontinental movements to Europe and across oceans. And the third thing that was relatively new was the degree of toxicity. Europe had politically been able to accept Muslim refugees from Bosnia and Kosovo in the 1990s. 9/11 and its aftermath changed that. So the challenge of fragility, mobility, and toxicity marked this out as a different kind of crisis. And the European challenge, particularly in 2015, was the test case to see whether Europe and the world were prepared to meet the challenge that would be presented to them for the rest of the 21st century. And we demonstrably failed. The legacy of that period is multifaceted. 9,500 people have drowned trying to reach Europe. And Brexit wouldn't have happened but for the way in which that crisis was represented. The slogans of breaking point and take back control were used by the Leave campaign. The posters showed not people coming from Poland or the Czech Republic or Bulgaria to the UK, but the European refugee crisis of Syrians on the Balkan route. And it's left the European project, including its common European asylum system, in tatters. What I want to do briefly is flesh out how we understand that problem. Because without a clear diagnosis of what the real problem is and where the real challenge lies, we're inevitably going to fail to find solutions. So I'll do that in three ways. Say something about the European crisis. Why did we fail as the European Union and as individual member states? Secondly, when we stand back from that, what's the purpose of Refuge? What should a functioning refugee policy and system be trying to achieve? And thirdly, what are the real challenges that enable us to meet that purpose? The European crisis stems, we would suggest, from dysfunctional institutions, both at the European level and globally. The European Common Asylum System was created in the aftermath of the creation of Schengen. If you're going to create a common market or a customs union, you have to be able to have free movement of goods, services, and people within your regional economic community. And to do that, you have to have a common external border, and logically, therefore, you can only have a single asylum policy, or so European policymakers believed. And so in the 1990s, in the aftermath of creating Schengen, the Treaty of Amsterdam ushered in the common European asylum system. And it had a series of ways of harmonizing, directives that tried to harmonize standards around procedures, who would be recognized as a refugee, who would qualify, what the reception standards would be. But it had as its cornerstone the Dublin system, the basis on which responsibility would be allocated, that the frontline states, the first arrival countries like Italy and Greece, would be those that took the overwhelming responsibility. If an asylum seeker arrived in your territory, you should process that claim, you should protect them if they're refugees, and they shouldn't be able to move onwards. But that Dublin system was not designed for large movements. And as we reached the Syria crisis from 2011 onwards, it began to struggle and wane under pressure. The European response we divide into three phases. Between 2011 and 2014, the European response to the crisis can be characterized as heartlessness. In that period, millions, literally, of Syrians crossed to Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon. Those countries took up the strain and faced a massive development and security challenge. And yet Europe buried its head in the sand and failed to provide adequate support. The second phase came very briefly in a window in 2015 from August, after Angela Merkel pronounced Wir schaffen das. And it was a period of the headless heart, a noble sense that if we open the door and welcome people, that was the morally right thing to do. But irrespective of how we judge that, it proved unsustainable. Within 5 months, Merkel was conspiring with the European Union and the government of Turkey to close the Balkans route, close the Aegean Sea, and return people back to Turkey. So that window closed, and we went into a third phase of, again, heartlessness, the heartless head, if you like. And our argument is we don't need to lurch between heartlessness and headlessness. We can balance head and heart and have thoughtful, sensible solutions. But to do that, we have to have a sense of what's going wrong. What's going wrong with our institutions? Well, I've said what's not working about the European Union system. It doesn't have a functional model of responsibility sharing. It's poorly adapted. Dublin and its relationship to Schengen is not working. But the global institutions are also stuck in a time warp. The global refugee system is based on two pillars: the 1951 Refugee Convention and the work of the UN Refugee Agency, UNHCR. And they were created for the aftermath of the Second World War, for the early Cold War period. And in part, they reflect that. Their work reflects that, and they need to be updated. The 1951 Convention contains within it a very particular definition of a refugee, someone fleeing persecution. And while many people today flee tyrannical regimes, the majority are fleeing fragile states. They're fleeing states that can't provide basic security to their citizens, can't provide basic human rights, because they're failing. It's countries like Somalia, Afghanistan, and Syria. And so what happens is courts are expected to shoehorn the contemporary circumstances of refugees into this antiquated definition of persecution. And many judges and courts do a good job with an antiquated definition. But it leads to very idiosyncratic responses. If you're an Eritrean refugee, you have a 24% chance of being recognized as a refugee if you go to France, and an 100% chance of being recognized if you go to Sweden. For much of the 1990s, Germany wouldn't even recognize refugees from South Central Somalia because there was no government to flee from. So that idiosyncrasy shows the weakness. It's not that we should necessarily throw it out, but it's not providing all the answers today. Meanwhile, UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, is an indispensable organization. We need a UN Refugee Agency. But where it's focusing its staff and its resources today are not where the real challenges lie. It's become very good at two things. First of all, it's very good at providing legal advice to governments, but it's providing that advice based on a legal framework that is significantly being ignored by many governments. A significant proportion of the major host governments around the world haven't even signed the 1951 Convention. Equally, it's become very good at providing care and maintenance, mainly in refugee camps, but that's not where they should be focusing. The two things we should be demanding of a refugee agency are skills in development and economics to make jobs for refugees in the host countries, and political leadership, the capacity to do political analysis and engage. But time and time again, UNHCR emphasizes its non-political mandate, and as they've said to us, it's not a jobs agency. So if we step back from that broken system, what should a good system be for? What is the purpose of Refuge? One of the arguments we put forward is we've lost that real purpose. That in the European refugee crisis, refuge has become bound up with the politically toxic discussions on globalization and migration. And it doesn't belong in that box. It should inspire not fear amongst the public, but it should inspire compassion, solidarity based on our common humanity. And yet the way it's being managed by politicians and narrated leads it to be understood as synonymous with the right to immigrate. And with sensible policies, it doesn't have to mean that. Refuge done well is about providing three sets of things to refugees. First of all, a basic duty of rescue. We should be providing security, food, clothing, and shelter. But that by itself is not enough. Refugees are getting stuck in refugee camps. The average length of stay in camps is around 2 decades, where refugees often lack jobs, adequate educational opportunities, freedom of movement. So that duty is one part. The second thing we have to offer, crucially, is autonomy. People have to be able to help themselves and their families by being able to work. Jobs is what underlies autonomy. And yet we deny that in most refugee-hosting countries around the world. And the third thing we need is a route out of limbo. Now, for most, that will involve going home. Refugees are not migrants. They're a proportion of the population that chose not to migrate before the crisis or conflict. And yet, they're unable often to go home. We need to be able to support the conditions for them to go home. But if beyond a certain cutoff they can't, then we should have ways in which they can be resettled elsewhere, but coherently, strategically, and systematically. So if we recognize those purposes, what's the real problem that we need to solve? Well, the real problem relies on understanding geographically where the challenge lies. 90% of the world's refugees are in developing regions of the world. They are not in Europe. 0.2% of Syrian refugees have come to the United Kingdom. About 50% are in Turkey. Just 10 host countries, all in developing regions, host 60% of the world's refugees. Now, the tragedy is that for every pound of public money we spend on an asylum seeker here, we spend less than a penny on that 90% of refugees per refugee in those safe haven countries. Now, you can argue that we should absolutely be supporting those that are here, that we've committed to help, but it's clearly a parallel tragedy that we neglect those in the haven countries, and that's where we place the emphasis. The challenge, though, is today, the people in those countries face an impossible choice. They can stay in camps and not be able to work year on year, or they can go, as many do, the majority now, to cities, where they're denied both assistance and the right to work, facing that double bind, or they can embark on perilous journeys, as we've seen in Europe. That's an impossible choice that shouldn't be the way it is today. We have historical examples of success that point the way to an alternative. As early as the interwar years in the 1920s, Greece, faced with people fleeing the collapsed Ottoman Empire, provided work opportunities, provided plots of land, provided economic opportunity with support from the International Labour Organization. In the 1960s and 70s, African host countries allowed refugees to self-settle and work and contribute to their economies. In Central America, in the 1990s, after the end of the Cold War, the European community provided funding to support the local integration of Guatemalan refugees in the Yucatan Peninsula. The refugees benefited, and it contributed to the development of the Yucatan Peninsula. In a case study I know very well, Uganda, that country has embarked on a novel approach to refugees. It gives them the right to work. It gives them freedom of movement, unlike its neighbors, like Kenya. And in data we've collected in Oxford, we've been able to show that that benefits refugees and it benefits the Ugandan economy. So the challenge for us is that workable solutions rely on creating the conditions for autonomy, the conditions for development, and the conditions for job. And Paul will flesh that out.
Thanks. So, where we've got to is this sort of toxic position where refugees who should be an object of universal compassion are actually an object of fear posed against moral grandstanding. So part of the population says, we're not the racists, we want them here, and the other part of the population is frightened. And that polarized and divisive position means that nothing, practical happens. And that's true not just in Britain, but globally, right? And it doesn't have to be like that, because out there are perfectly feasible policies that could dramatically change the situation, provide opportunity for refugees, and would be unifying. We could, everybody who isn't a psychopath could agree on it, right? It's only if we can get something with very broad consensus that we can actually get practical policy action, right? Get out of the theater of polarized opposition and look for the unifying propositions. So what is the unifying proposition here? There are actually two of them, and it struck us very forcibly just by being in Jordan and seeing what a tragedy it was and what an avoidable tragedy. One thing, let's go back to that phase of the heartless head from 2011 until 2015. 10 million people displaced in Syria. We all knew about that. Half of them get across a border to these proximate havens. Why do they go to the proximate havens? Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon. Because they're proximate. That's where 90% of the world's refugees go, is to the nearby havens. They're not migrants wanting to get to California. They're people who wanted to stay home, homes become unsafe, they go to the nearest safe haven in the hopes that they can go back home when the conflict's over. Sometimes those hopes will be realized, sometimes they'll be frustrated, right? But the solution is not get everybody to California or a California lookalike place. It's try and make living in these regional havens consistent with human autonomy, dignity. That means able to earn a living. As Alex said, people so want autonomy that they bypass the camps. The model served up by the international community, the only model, is live in a camp for free. Free food, free shelter, forever. Right? And people don't want that. They're infantilized. And so in Syria, a large majority of the refugees, 83%, actually ignored the camps, went into the towns, where they were at the bottom of the heap because they were illegal. So the first thing is to get jobs to these regional haven countries around the world, 10 of them. The only thing they got in common, those 10, they're not particularly welcoming or heroic or rich. They're all poor countries of emigration. What they've got in common is they're all close to places of disorder. So we've got to help the haven countries that are proximate to disorder. And we didn't. We sat on our hands, Europe, for 4 years whilst Jordan, Turkey, and Lebanon bore a huge and increasing burden. That's why we were called into Jordan, because the Jordanian government was heading into a crisis of how could they finance this? Their debt to GDP ratio, which started off as manageable, was becoming unmanageable. Right? And we did nothing. So that's the first thing, is we must make it financially feasible for the regional haven countries to meet their duty of rescue. Their duty of rescue is provide safe haven. Our duty of rescue is make it feasible for the countries that are proximate to provide that safe haven. They needed big money and they didn't get it. Right? We actually managed to, the government of Jordan saw that problem. World Bank eventually saw the problem. British government saw the problem. They jointly convened a conference here just over a year ago, which was a pledging conference. Not just a pledging conference, but it was a pledging conference. Britain pledged, I think, £1 billion and paid it. Other countries have pledged and haven't paid it. There's an enormous gulf in Europe between what they say they'll do and what they actually do. Right? This is shaming. Right? A lot of the money has been diverted to the small number of refugees in Europe. Sweden, for example, that heroic, noble place that's welcomed all those refugees, how's it paid for it? It's halved its aid budget to pay for it. So who's actually paid for it? Is it the Swedes? No, it's some of the poorest people in the world have paid for these refugees in Sweden. Who are the refugees who've gone to Europe? They're not a random selection of the Syrian population. The people leaving Syria as refugees were a random sample. We've got the demographics, because fear strikes randomly around the territory. But the people who came to Europe, this small minority, were highly demographically selective. First of all, you had to be pretty well off. Buying a place on one of these people smugglers' boats was more than the annual income of the average Syrian, and you had to pay cash. So that immediately tells you who's going to come. Just have you got the cash, you know? Think of you, which of you have got more than your annual income in cash? It'll be the richer ones, but it's worse than that, because it was educationally very selective. Less than 5% of Syrians in Europe, something between a third and a half of all Syrians with a university degree. That inadvertently is disastrous, because who will be the people most needed to rebuild Syria as a post-conflict society when it gets back to some form of peace? It's going to be the people with a university education. I've spent a lot of my life working on post-conflict recovery, and it's not about concrete. That's the image. You think you're rebuilding bridges. What you're actually doing is rebuilding organizations. You need the highly educated people, and they're not there anymore. They're here. So that's one of our duties, is to help the haven countries. And then the other duty is to provide jobs. That's the bit which gives the refugees dignity and autonomy. How do we do it? What's our role? Well, as Alex said, we didn't get this idea from pondering textbooks. We got it from looking at the refugee camp and the industrial dome 15 minutes away. You don't have to have two professors to work that out, an empty zone and a full camp. What was missing in that zone, apart from the legal right of refugees to work, what was really missing was firms. Jordan doesn't have the firms. We do. And the good side of globalization, the stuff that isn't frightening, is that firms, which 50 years ago didn't go transnational, now as a matter of routine do. For example, Germany, Europe's biggest center for manufacturing, has for years, decades, been performing that manufacturing by splitting stages of factory production to the near offshore. The first stage in the 1990s, the near offshore was Poland. So some activities within a factory would be done in Germany. Some would still be computer controlled and integrated, but they'd be done just across in Poland. And then as Polish wages got higher, that shifted to Turkey. So thousand upon thousand of German-generated jobs have been employing Turks. Some spectacular examples of very fast development. For example, over half the synthetic carpets in the world are made in a nowhere town in central Turkey. That's the sort of miracle of modern globalization that's so useful. Jobs can grow in a cluster fast. If you can do it in Turkey, you can certainly do it in Jordan. What were the impediments? One was European Community's trade policy. It had got free access for goods made in Turkey, but trade barriers against goods made in Jordan. So we went to Brussels. That, the European Community changed. It took them 8 months to do it, but they changed. Free access now for 10 years for Jordan. So trade stuff done. And then the other is getting the finance that makes it viable for a company to go and try that new activity in an unknown area. And that's a matter of redirecting some of the huge amounts of money that are available, both for refugees and especially for post-conflict reconstruction, to that task. You're actually killing two birds with one stone. You're providing jobs and dignity for refugees whilst they're in the havens, but the firms that are employing refugees, if and when the conflict country gets back to peace, that firm can set up an operation in the post-conflict country with that part of its workforce that wants to go back. So, the vital step in all this, and I'm near to done, the vital step was to change the attitude of the Jordanian government. The Jordanian government had very evident concerns that any government would have. It couldn't provide enough jobs for Jordanians, let alone worry about jobs for Syrians. If it started to let Syrians work legally, it would have been out of office. And so this had to be something that the Jordanian government could genuinely sell to Jordanian citizens as, this is good for us. And that wasn't hard, because the Jordanian government's biggest concern was that it was in what's called a middle income trap. It was stuck at $10,000 to $12,000 per capita a year. What it wanted was to get above that, and for that it needed the big international firms, and Jordan wasn't on the map for the big international firms. So we said to the government of Jordan, the one way you'll get on the map is because you've got a lot of refugees. There's your opportunity. You are looking a gift horse in the mouth. Hurry up, because if those refugees move to Europe, you've lost your opportunity. Get moving. Right? And they did. They did. Right? That was the second part of the February 2016 conference, jobs. Get firms in Europe to take jobs to the haven countries. And that started to happen. The Governor of Jordan said, as long as there are jobs brought in, and as long as Jordanians can get about 30% of those jobs, the rest will give work permits to refugees in very large numbers. I mean, the numbers they were talking about, something like 200,000, which is huge. If you got that sort of number, every refugee family in Jordan would have one of these proper jobs. Right? So that was fantastic. Right? So over to the firms. And that's also started to happen. This whole thing only got ignited officially just a matter of months ago. Already there's supposed to be, I think, 38,000 refugee jobs created by this just in Jordan. And already this is spotted as a model. It's actually called the Jordan model. And the government of Ethiopia has now already copied this. In fact, Chancellor Merkel went to visit in January the industrial zone in Ethiopia, which is now employing both refugees and Ethiopians. And I met up with the Ethiopian government when they were here just 2 weeks ago, and their big priority was to say, do you think we can get European firms to come with this refugee model? Because they say, we've already got the Chinese firms. Chinese firms are good, but actually the real heavyweight lifting that Ethiopia needs to develop will be done by the European and American firms. Can we get them to come in? So that's the opportunity. Finally, where does UNHCR fit into this? Where does the World Bank? I used to work for the World Bank as director of research. So I went to the World Bank and said, where are you in Jordan? Where were they? They were missing in action. Right? There was a very simple reason for it. They said, sorry, $10,000, $12,000 per capita? We're not allowed to operate in it. It's an upper middle income country. 1 million refugees? Oh no, if it's refugees, it's UNHCR. Right? Really? Right? The board wouldn't let us. Have you asked the board? No. Do you think you should try? And there they did. They devised a loan to take to create jobs for refugees and Jordanian citizens in the zones. They took it to the board. Every single member of that board wanted to speak and say, this is a good idea. Why have we not done it before? 60 years later than it needed to have been, but they've done it. Right? So that was the World Bank. Where's UNHCR? Well, the phrase that Alex gave, we're not a job agency, that's what UNHCR said to us in response to this. Right? We're not a job agency. That is an accurate description, but unfortunately, what refugees most need and most want is a jobs agency. Right? So UNHCR, as Alex said, vital to have an international agency focused on refugees, it really needs to shift out of this humanitarian silo into doing a proper job for refugees. It's not anymore food, shelter, it's jobs. Thanks very much.
Okay, that was, I think, hope you agree, quite provoking, quite interesting for those of us that that didn't necessarily think there was a very obvious alternative. So what I'm going to do now is take questions, comments. I know we've got people here, various different sort of perspectives. So seeing how many we have. Anyone up for asking a question? We've got a couple of roving mics, Alex and Ewan there. And if anyone's in the other room and would like to come in, there's some spaces here and then you can ask questions. So Ewan, we have someone in the corner. And please tell us who you are.
Hi, William Wallace. Paul, you focused on the last 3 years, really, but I just want to raise the question of the longer-term context of the migrant crisis. On the Brexit theme, I found myself at one point in the campaign talking to a large group of people in Ripon Cathedral and ended my bit on the migrant crisis by saying, look, we have a much larger migrant crisis long-term, which is to do with population growth, instability because of population growth and poor governments and climate change. And the question we've all got to address is, who is my neighbor? And when they came back after waking up into seminars, one of them said, and we've been discussing who is not my neighbor, which is a fairly good summary of the problems of getting your population to accept it. What it seems to me we have been facing in the last 3 years is partly the outcome of conflict and social breakdown in a number of countries, but in countries like South Sudan and Somalia, it is connected with rapid rises in population and deterioration in agriculture, water, whatever. I read a note on Iran last Tuesday, which suggested that long-term drought and water shortages in Iran suggest that 5 million people need to leave Iran in the next 10 years. Now, we have not managed the crisis of the last 3 years terribly well. How are we going to manage the long-term pressures from these countries, some in conflict, some suffering from the doubling of population and the exhaustion of limited agricultural opportunities? Can we go on absorbing more, or what do we have to do in addition to what we're currently doing?
You might have noticed, or you may have missed it, but a couple of weeks ago, a group of us launched an independent commission on state fragility, which is being chaired by David Cameron and Dal Kabaruka, 10-year president of the African Development Bank, with a stellar international group of commissioners, because indeed we need to get better at addressing state fragility. But I would just distinguish between, as it were, deep causes and tractable points of intervention. Right? And that's a very important thing to distinguish, right? It's hard to grasp it, but there is no necessary logical connection between the cause of a problem and its solution. Right? Suppose, dread to think of it, you fell off a cliff and broke your leg. Right? The solution to your problem is not to climb back up the cliff. Right? The solution to the problem is quite separate from the cause. Right? And what we are looking for in our Fragile States Commission, and what we're looking for here, is practical, tractable points of intervention. Yes, maybe it's going to be caused by climate change. There's climate change over the next 50 years is locked in, man. Locked in, because it's the stuff that's already been put up there, right? So if that's the cause, there is nothing we can do about it to stop the cause, but we've got to build resilience to cope with the consequences. And so don't expect any miracles anytime soon. There are a lot of fragile states. Every now and then, one or two will implode. As Alex started by saying, you know, most of the refugees in the world are just three countries. Huh? You can't predict those implosions. And so we've got to build systems that can anticipate there will be some implosions and do something about it. We do know pretty well that those next implosions will be proximate to one of these 10 haven countries. They keep taking influxes of refugees from different countries, but it's always pretty well the same 10 haven countries. So if we build long-term economic support for refugees in then those 10 haven countries, we've done it. And it is so doable. The numbers, 20 million, are really very small relative to global economic capacity now.
Yeah. Looks like we need another event with David Cameron and some colleague when he...
And I guess you'll get
producing
one.
When... his, producing his Fragile States event, which is another extremely interesting question. Yes, you understand down the row.
Thanks. Michael Anderson from the Center for Global Development. I'm sure you addressed this in the book, so I'll just give you a chance to explain. If you do away with Article 1 of the 1951 Convention and think about a new definition, one that is linked to, say, fragility and people seeking to be safe, how would you go about defining that? And I'm particularly thinking if you create incentives for people to seek jobs, knowing that, oh gosh, if I go to Jordan, they've got this great program, and there's going to be some Jordanian border guard who has to take a decision about do I let you in or not, right?
So just, I'm just about to hand over to Alex.
Yeah, I was going to say.
One point
so,
I want to say to
you. So just, you know, how do you, the whole world, I'm sure, is going to raise the question of, you know, how do you distinguish between refugees and economic migrants? And I'd love to hear how you operationalize that.
Yeah, just before Alex does all the refugee stuff, don't forget, if Jordan did become more attractive to refugees, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Two-thirds of the global displaced at the moment can't get across an international border or don't get across it. They're living dangerously. And so part of the solution, the problem group we should really focus on is not the 20 million refugees, it's the 65 million displaced. And so providing better opportunities in haven countries, if that sucks in more of the displaced, that's good. It's part of the solution.
Does the Jordanian government think that?
As long as it generates jobs for Jordanians as well, I don't think there's any pushback. It's the Jordanian government that made this happen as practical politics,
okay.
Not us.
Okay, let's go to Alex for his new definition.
To be very clear, we're not arguing to ditch the 1951 Convention, but we are making very clear that we shouldn't depend on it, that it doesn't provide all of the answers, and that actually, while some states some of the time may adhere to the 1951 Convention, it leaves a lot of gaps and there's a huge amount of non-compliance. So if we want solutions, we have to be pragmatic, we have to engage with the political reality, not just preach the legal framework. So if that framework is struggling to cope with contemporary circumstances, it's fairly unrealistic in the current political climate to get 193 states together to say, agree another hard law legal framework to replace Article 1A. So I think the way to do it is to say, there are a group of people who willfully fragile states, who are fleeing fragile states, who will flee the consequences of climate change for fragile states. And we can't just bury our heads in the sand. We need to update the people we protect. And probably the best practical way to do it is to sort of come up with soft law frameworks that consolidate those ideas, that reach common harmonized agreements across states. And there are some initiatives to try and do that, particularly around the discussions on the global compact on safe, orderly, managed migration, which are underway to report to a major UN summit in 2018 or maybe 2019. Where do we draw the line? The concept we use in the book is the idea of force majeure. The idea that there are some things which create such significant levels of danger that a reasonable person could not be expected to remain in their country of origin. Now, in some ways, that carries with it the often common interpretation of persecution, which is general harm. But it goes further than that, because it would ideally seek to clarify that if you're fleeing a collapsed state, if you can't eat, if you're facing a severe famine, or severe drought, and you have to cross a border, you too need a safe haven, whether very temporary or more long term. And so force majeure is the concept that we try to develop a little bit within the book.
Okay, yes, Alex, Stephen, and then we'll go back. Yeah,
Stephen Hale from a UK charity called Refugee Action. I wanted to make three, I promise, very quick points. The first is just to thank you, because goodness knows we need practical solutions and new ideas, so it's great that you've stepped up and put this together. Second thing I was going to say is that although it's clearly true that many refugees desperately want work, it's also the case that a number of refugees aren't fit to work and they're highly vulnerable and they fall totally outside the story you're telling. And I think it's important to look at how that's going to be addressed and how that's going to be supported. And obviously one of the ways in which we do that at the moment is that some countries are resettling vulnerable refugees that the UN believes cannot survive, cannot prosper in those countries. And of course the UK is a part of that, and at Refugee Action we do a lot of work with those groups. So I just want to ask you how you're dealing with vulnerable refugees that aren't going to find work. And then the last point I was going to make is coming a little bit to the way the UK is handling this. At the moment, the narrative from the UK is very strong, that anybody who's coming through the asylum route is a bad refugee, is clearly wealthy enough, is making an economic choice, and basically there's a disbelieving system, whereas those people who've waited patiently and come through the vulnerable person scheme should be treated and embraced in a very different way. And I wanted to ask you about that, because it seems to me, although you offered statistics about Syria, it's also the case that a lot of very, very desperate people are making those journeys because there are no safe and legal ways for them to make those journeys. And I worry that in the UK, by building that two-tier system, we're demonizing the majority of people who come to the UK. And in addition, we're in a sense trying to say the only people we want are the people that will make no contribution to our country. And I think it would be deeply unfortunate if we get into a position where people who come, who claim asylum or are recognized as refugees, can't go to university, can't set up jobs because they're not given the support in the UK to rebuild their lives. And I think that would be quite damaging to our politics as well as to them.
Alex, you want to take those up?
Yeah, great questions, Stephen. I mean, I think it's a very valid concern to say not all refugees have the capabilities and capacities to work. Some are vulnerable. Some are vulnerable because of what they've experienced in war and crisis. Some were vulnerable before the crisis took hold. And so I think we need to continue to address their needs. There are ways in which we do engage with that in the book. The first thing we argue is that resettlement, although it needs to be used much more strategically and thoughtfully, should continue to be an important tool. And we suggest there are two ways in which it's important. First of all, for those who are too vulnerable to remain in the safe havens. And secondly, for those who, beyond a certain designated cutoff, maybe it's 7 years, maybe it's 10 years, are unlikely to be able to go home, and so we need a coherent way of giving them an opportunity to get on with their lives. 3 years in limbo may be acceptable, possibly even five. 10 years, definitely not. 20 years, definitely not. So we say resettlement, an important part for those two functions. We also say that actually, in terms of thinking about global responsibility sharing, there are two principles. One is comparative advantage. Not all governments have the capacity to contribute equally in equal ways. Countries like Uganda can provide territory, countries like the UK should primarily be providing money. But the second principle is solidarity. All countries should be doing a little bit of everything, both because it symbolically matters and because it's a gesture where the message resonates with those countries in the safe haven region. So we're very clear that countries like the UK should still be taking some refugees, but we should be doing it thoughtfully and strategically. We also recognise, and we're very explicit on this, that while there's no absolute right to migrate for anybody, and we're even clear that we don't think that refugees, by virtue of being refugees, should have a right to choose exactly where they live in the world, but we say that until the safe havens provide an adequate level of opportunity, protection and support, then the cart shouldn't become before the horse. And so migration is a contingent right that refugees have insofar as it's necessary to get access to rescue, autonomy, and eventually a route out of limbo. So I hope that we're clear on that in the book. And I think your point about vulnerabilities is important, but we do also want to emphasize that it's not just about vulnerabilities, it's also about capabilities. And for too long, we've only emphasized the vulnerability, when for those that are able to contribute and want to contribute, we should be empowering them and offering enabling environments.
So Stephen, are you persuaded?
Well, there's always more in the book than there is in the
open. That's one reason why we have questions, and why that I'm sure that they like you very much by the book.
You said a lot about the first issue I raised, but I'd be interested in your perspective on the UK, because essentially the UK narrative is we spend lots of money over there, and if it's really, really bad for them, we'll possibly let them, a small number, come over here, and after that, you know, as I said, there's a, you know, a high, the UK's ideal objective is that nobody comes here to claim asylum. And the reality is that we have a broken international system where, as you said, people cannot rebuild their lives, and many people are coming after trying to rebuild, after trying to make the effort you're describing, but they haven't got those opportunities, and so they are sacrificing everything. An entire family might be pooling all their money to enable one person to make a journey in the hope that it can keep them going and a family behind. And I think that we're a long way off fixing this system, and until that happens, it's really important that we don't contaminate our own public debate by politicising and demonising those people who make that dangerous and difficult choice.
So reading your book, one of the interesting things about your book is that Angela Merkel, you know, with the Wir schaffen das, comes out as a sort of, you know, you put her down as the headless heart. So she emerges as a bit of a sort of, you know, don't like to use the word villain of the piece, but, you know, not a very positive actor in this. Implicitly, though you don't say it, David Cameron, who is one of your pieces at the back, saying, just recommending the book, his policy of actually more support in the proximate countries and much less of a sort of open doors policy emerges implicitly as having got it righter than Merkel. I just wonder whether, you know, we would take up Stephen's challenge there and say a bit more about Angela Merkel's decision making, because I think that's very interesting. Interesting piece of the book, particularly in the context of what's going on in Europe now.
I mean, we're not interested in the individuals as individuals. We're interested in the policies. And I don't think we would in any way characterise Merkel as the villain. We recognise that the decision she made in August was a very noble one, and for very good reasons. But the fact is that less than 6 months later, she'd U-turned on her own decisions. The fact that she'd decided to collude with the European Union and Turkey to close the Balkan route and the Aegean Sea less than 6 months after saying we will cope, we'll open our doors, I think the evidence of contradiction suggests that there's an implicit acknowledgement that she thinks she got it wrong. Meanwhile, I think we should give credit where it's due, in part, to the things the UK government has done well. The willingness to pilot the work in Jordan to support the policies in Ethiopia is a very good one. DFID is a very functional development agency. It does a lot of good work for refugees in the safe haven countries. Now, the tragedy is that other governments don't follow that example, that there's not necessarily a mobilization of those ideas at the UN level. Now, Stephen, there's a lot that needs to be done in the UK for vulnerable people who are in our own societies. And there are a lot of gaps for people who come here. I, for one, would have supported the Dubs Amendment's implementation. And I think that's because once people are on your doorstep, particularly children, you have absolute obligations to ensure they integrate. Similarly, Germany, having taken 500,000 refugees during 2015, has an absolute obligation to support that population. It's taken that on, and therefore it should discharge that responsibility seriously. But I also think we need to recognize that in addition to taking country-specific approaches, there's a system-level challenge. And if we can make the system work for the 90% that are in developing countries, then in future, we may have less need for people to embark on dangerous journeys to come to Europe. But that doesn't, as you rightly highlight, mean that we can relinquish the responsibility to those who are here, who are in our societies, and have the needs that your organisation is trying to address.
Paul, do you want to come in?
I'm working very closely with Chancellor Merkel at the moment on the Africa initiative that Germany is doing as president of the G20, right? And that is wholly admirable. I definitely wouldn't buy into the Chancellor Merkel as the villain of the peace story one little bit, right? The part of the argument of our book is that this is a, internationally, globally, this is a deeply flawed system that could not have produced other than tragedy, because it's just not equipped for the needs of refugees. It's not equipped to do anything economic, and it's certainly not equipped to do anything economic in the haven countries. Faced with that dilemma of a totally broken international system, Europe's politicians experimented on the hoof. And David Cameron tried one thing, Chancellor Merkel tried another. One proved much more sustainable than the other. Okay? The very brief open door in Germany really hasn't worked out very well. Quite aside from being highly selective, it's not delivered the main thing that the refugees who have gone to Germany want, which is a job. I think the proportion of Syrian refugees in Germany who actually have a job is something like 14%, despite the fact that Germany's awash with jobs. But it's, German firms are in a wonderful position to generate jobs for Syrian refugees in Jordan. But they're in a completely hopeless position to do that job in Germany, because Germany is the ultimate high minimum wage, credentials, training, long periods of certification. And so it can't do it with the best will in the world. It can't do it, right? So both of the two European politicians who responded most vigorously to the crisis were Merkel and Cameron. And as it happens, Cameron did something much more innovative and much more sustainable. And we should be acknowledging that. Has British policy been perfect? Of course not. But it has innovated in a very important and very neglected dimension. And the British refugee community needs to get round that and push it further. You know, the refugee organisation, the refugee NGOs, all of you should be talking to business, because it's business that can generate what refugees most need. And historically, the British refugee NGO community hasn't talked with business. If anything, it's been rather hostile to business. And that is a catastrophic mistake which needs to change.
Okay, let's take another question here. Yeah, you're in touch.
Hi, I'm Heather Smith, I'm a civil servant, and so you can't see a good case study without wanting to scale it up as a bureaucrat. But it strikes me that you're very much talking about the policy challenges, but the key blockers here are often people challenges. They're about people who can't see the opportunity, for example, NGOs with business or governments with economic zones and refugee camps, and they're also about political leadership. So I was just going to ask, obviously you're both extremely experienced in influencing people to take steps forward in global development. Have you learned anything from this issue, and how much further do you think we've got to go before the lessons you've learned in Jordan could be implemented more widely?
Thank you. I think this is very doable. I've now been working in the public policy space for a long time, and this one, I think, is one of the easier ones, really, because it's in so many agencies and politicians' interests. It really is win-win, as the Americans would say. You know, it's not divisive, and so the only reason it hasn't happened, I mean, it is happening now. Never mind, it is happening. The board of the World Bank has changed. Ethiopian government's picked it up. You know, there's a kind of mushroom. The reason it took so long to happen was that if it had the label refugee on it, internationally, it was siloed in a monopoly agency, UNHCR, which had a big keep off sign and which only did humanitarian. Remember that proud response to us, we're not a jobs agency? You know.
So Paul, do you think that's changing now? I mean, so you've said the World Bank, whatever, do you think UNHCR is changing? And
we've had
a separate silo of UNDP sitting there who does development. Are they now seeing this as a joint project?
We've had a lot of conversations with the UNHCR. Staff were invited to go and give seminars. Every single one of the senior UNHCR staff that I've talked to, I mean, Alex talks with more, but everyone that I've talked to says, well, of course, we agree with you. Whether they're brave enough to say so in public, but that's what they think. Alex.
Yeah, I mean, I think UNHCR is moving. Rhetorically, they want to work with the World Bank. Rhetorically, they recognise refugee self-reliance is important. But it's being bold and brave to engage in very practical ways this new world. And I think the key thing is, in spite of the rhetoric of change within those organisations, the allocation of resources, the proportions of their staff capacity that have abilities like economics and political analysis are tiny. I mean, I think they've got one or two professional economists in an organisation packed with lawyers.
9,000 people?
Yeah, so it's the reality of where you look at the allocation of staff and the allocation of resources tells a more fundamental story. Now, I think in terms of vested interests, you can't necessarily ask UN organisations to reform themselves. We can see that across the board. The impetus has to come from donors. Donors asking for more from UN agencies. Being prepared to say, these are the kinds of things we want you to do. This is how we want you to do them. What are you doing? And the request I think donors need to make to UNHCR is, what is your strategy for the 21st century? How are you changing your business model? And I think often there's a sort of almost regulatory capture where donors listen to the organizations they fund for the strategy and the guidance and direction. But I also think on a different level, one of the reasons why these kinds of policies are hard to roll out, I mean, we've got the right to work for refugees in Uganda. It's much harder to push in countries like Kenya or Thailand or Tanzania or even Jordan. The reason it's difficult is also because of the political economy in those countries. There are vested interests, there are gatekeepers. But that's a reason why we need agencies, UN agencies like UNHCR, to have political analysis capacity, to look at where the gatekeepers are, identify what the bottlenecks are, so that we can pull the levers of change and not just bury our heads in the sand and assume that a conversation with one minister or a conversation with a head of state is what leaves the door to be closed. On the Ethiopian case that was announced at the Obama Refugee Summit on the 20th of September, one interesting thing that a State Department official said was that initially the US government were very afraid about approaching governments like Ethiopia and saying, could you offer jobs to refugees? It was sort of a taboo that they would freak out and run away. And actually, they said they were surprised that when they actually asked the question and understood the interests underlying the answer, they could make progress.
Okay, I'm going to take last questions. So if you've got a burning question, well, we've suddenly got loads of questions. Okay, we're going to take all these last questions, and I'm going to ask Paul and Alex to sum up, and then we're going to go outside. So Alex just there, and then Ewan here, and then we'll move down there, and that'll be it. Yes.
Can I just ask you to?
Can you tell us who you are?
Sure, Luke Ravensroth from Bayland's IT. Can you just
give us a bit more detail on how these economic zones work? I mean, two on my mind would be, what are the incentives you offer firms? And you mentioned the guarantee with the Jordanian government of 30% of the, like, is that a kind of concrete guarantee, or are you just sort of estimating that and then seeing how you go?
Okay, so that's one about the practicalities of the zones. Yeah?
Vicky Price from CBR. I missed the beginning, so you may have covered it then, but is Brexit going to make it harder for us to have an influence on this?
Okay, is Brexit going to, very good, bringing back to our Brexit theme from Vicky, thanks very much. And yes,
well, that was pretty much my question as well. Is the environment that we are now moving into, where the UK is proud of what it's doing in terms of aid, going to be one in which we will be competing with the EU and thereby generating more?
Okay, I think it's a very interesting place to end. So, practicalities of the Jordanian economic zone, and I suppose that goes to the question of how replicable is that as well.
So. Yeah, so don't forget, we're in early days with the zones. So we're going to learn, the whole system is going to learn as it goes. Right? There are a lot of actors moving into this space, a lot. One of the things that will happen is that the camps themselves are reconceptualized, not as camps where people are warehoused, but as temporary cities where people work. And so a lot of the jobs will actually be in temporary cities rather than in zones. The big advantage of the zones at the moment is that it's a very concrete thing that a government can say, there are these new jobs in these zones that wouldn't be here otherwise. Here's the firm that wouldn't be here otherwise. Here are Jordanian jobs, here are refugee jobs. Right? So it's a very concrete proposal. Right? That's the big attraction. Now, one of the things that's going to be evolve is, where does all this happen? Jordan's got a lot of industrial zones around the country. It's experimenting to see which of the zones firms are most willing to come to. Right? The jobs don't literally have to go to the refugees. The refugees can move within the country to the jobs. Right? So we're going to be feeling our way on this, but there's a lot of energy coming from companies and social enterprise. The really exciting space now is the social enterprise that's wanting to catalyse all this.
Okay, so the Brexit question hanging over us. I mean, is the UK about to model good practice and fail to persuade anyone else because we're deciding to embark on our separate path post-Brexit?
I think the first thing to say about Brexit in relation to the refugee crisis is Brexit would not have happened but for the refugee crisis. The Leave campaign depended upon it as the basis for its main slogans.
I'm doing an event with Douglas Carswell in 2 weeks, so I'm going to ask him that, because I'm not sure he'd necessarily agree, but anyway.
The fact that the top voting issues for Leave voters were migration and sovereignty, and the main slogans were breaking point and take back control, with posters of the movement of people across the Balkan route, I think highlight the importance. Yeah. Even if you claimed it was only at the margin of 3%, the result clearly depended upon what happened. Now, the challenge is, of course, in the aftermath, it's seen as providing a democratic mandate for even more restrictive policies on immigration. So that creates even more of an imperative to try to separate the refugee issue from that messy, hazy landscape of globalization and migration policy. We have a different set of obligations to that population, and we need policies that work for refuge. But it also means that the kind of things we're proposing can fit compatibly with reconciling democracy with the needs of refugees. Because they're not about necessarily unmanaged migration, but they're about ways of having a coherent policy, a consistent policy. Many of the general public, and opinion polls bear this out, support the right of refugees, provided there's a sense of order to how those policies are discharged. And I think as the government looks for this idea of global Britain, a role in the world, in development policy in general, but refugee policy in particular, becomes an area where we have a comparative advantage. Historically, Britain has played a leadership role in a number of areas of development, and particularly on refugee issues, not just the kinder transport, not just Ugandan Asians fleeing Idi Amin, but across the spectrum. And I think this can be seen as that latest chapter which reappropriates many of the patriotic narratives and uses them to do good and find meaningful solutions that serve the world.
So Paul, I just wanted to ask you a sort of final question on this. I mean, you're working with UNHCR, you're working with the World Bank, you've appointed David Cameron running this Federal States Commission. Do you get the sense that the UK is seeing any change its status as a player in those non-EU related institutions because of Brexit and because we won't be part of EU coordination? Are we establishing a sort of big independent and perhaps more powerful role for ourselves in them, or are we seen as sort of people with their own sets of problems and issues who are not perhaps the force we once were in determining policy there?
I think British international development policy is hugely admired globally, and with the demise of US international development policy, the gap between what we're doing and everybody else has just got a lot bigger. Probably shouldn't say this, but why not?
Why not?
I will.
You are on camera. You are being live streamed.
I understand that, but actually nobody official has paid either of us anything for any of the work we have done. Just let's go on record on that. We are not hired hands in this, right? I have heard, and this may be apocryphal, but in the first meeting between Chancellor Merkel and Prime Minister May, one of the things that Chancellor Merkel said was, do protect DFID, it's an international jewel. Yeah? That was post-Brexit, but it was a very clear bit of admiration, right? Already in the German G20 with the Africa Initiative, Britain and Germany are working like that, right? We're working together, right? And thank goodness we are, right? So I think that British leadership in this field really can continue. It's something we can all be pretty proud of. Is it perfect? No. Is it better than most others? Well, I do think it is.
Okay, I think that's a terrific point to end on, whatever. So the book, Refuge, is available outside. Paul and Alex. Alex is, I think, rushing away to another event at 7, so nab him early to get your copy signed. It does have possibly the most impressive set of acknowledgements on the back cover, ranging from Kofi Annan to David Cameron, Dambisa Moyo, David Miliband, George Akerlof, and Chris Anderson. I'm sure they'd like some endorsements from women as well. I'm not sure about Chris Anderson, actually. But anyway, but the men of the world clearly love the book.
Dambisa Moyo surely can.
Dambisa Moyo. Yeah, Dambisa Moyo is a woman. I forgot that. Anyway, so women as well like the book. So it's hugely, hugely positively endorsed. It's also a crackingly good read, could I just say, which I don't say of all books by academics, but it was a brilliant read on the Eurostar to and from Brussels the other weekend. Very easy reading. I think actually a model of how to write for policy audiences for academics. Any academics are watching on the live stream, so do take that up and write like that or whatever. It's not
God,
set by footnotes and stuff like
club.
That. No. I hope it's doing wonders for your ref status. Anyway, so I'm not going to detain you any longer here. There are drinks and canapés outside. As I said, there is a book available for purchase out there. Alex and Paul staying, but could you just briefly thank them all very much for coming?